for a lot of parents, they have children to carry on their dreams, carry on my legacy, and to do the things that I wanted to do that I never did, to bring me glory.
It's all part of a plan.
You lose whatever influence you could have had because you lose the respect of your child. At a certain point, they stop trying to win your approval.
And they just start rebelling.
In her case, the element of control and the element of expectation, there's love, but what comes first is you're here for this purpose. You're here for this path. Whether you choose it or not, it's been foisted upon you.
Get off me!
But at what point does it become a complex? And at what point are you not able to just enjoy your life or enjoy your relationship with your child?
Will you protect our son?
Good intentions don't translate into good actions. You have to honor the journey. You have to honor the free will.
And if your answer is no,
this is only the beginning.
You'll still be the only thing I ever needed you to be. My son.
Boom!
It's so good.
Slam dunk parenting right there. Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I am Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker, Sardukar, and I need therapy.
And my name is Jonathan Decker, House of Atreides licensed therapist, and I love movies. I already know what we're doing today.
We're talking about Dune. We're big giant nerds, and we're talking about Dune.
Well, first of all, Denis Villeneuve is one of the best...
Wait. Go back one.
What do you say?
First of all, Denis Villeneuve is one of the best...
Bring his face up. Full screen.
Villeneuve is...
Mother of God.
Spoken like a true Spanish speaker. Denis Villeneuve. It's French.
Well, I do speak Spanish, not French. So.
He's a French Canadian.
Denis Villeneuve. Mi hermano es un director increíble. Listen, I'm a gringo. What do you want from me?
Don't you forget about me.
This episode was actually brought to you by our Kickstarter producer, Aaliyah, big Dune fan, and she helped kickstart our short film that you star in, that I directed. Moonstruck.
Yeah.
It will be available on the Telekinesis Entertainment channel here on YouTube sometime soon from when this comes out, probably. But just look at that channel and you'll see it when it comes out. The focus here, because this is only the first half of the book, so it's not the entire Paul Atreides story.
Yeah.
But what we do get an awful lot of is parenting stuff from House Atreides.
Yes.
Paul's father, Duke Leto, his mother, Lady Jessica, and their different parenting styles. And I'd love to get your reaction to, like, good, bad, ugly. How would you raise a future Duke in the Galactic Empire?
How would I raise a future Sand Messiah?
Yeah. That sounds racist somehow.
Yeah, but you know, almost everything I say sounds
almost
racist.
Almost everything. We're white men. It all sounds racist coming out of our faces.
You're a football player. It's in your blood.
That's racist.
Your soul.
That's racist.
Your eyes.
That's gay.
That's homophobic. Okay.
That's black.
That's racist.
Damn.
Let's start this thing.
Okay.
I need you by my side.
So yeah, so far.
When we get to Arrakis, we'll face enormous danger.
What danger? Fremen? A desert?
Political danger.
Kind of authoritarian, maybe not great fathering, yeah?
The great houses look to us for leadership. And this threatens the Emperor. By taking Arrakis from the Harkonnens and making it ours, he sets the stage for a war, which would weaken both houses. But if we hold firm...
But he's talking to him like an equal. Here's why, and here's what's going on. Instead of, you don't need to know, you just need to obey.
What does that mean?
Yeah.
I want you sitting in on my council. Learn what I do.
What if I'm not, Dad?
Not what?
The future of House Atreides.
I told my father I didn't want this either.
I just love the work Hans Zimmer is doing right here.
I wanted to be a pilot.
Best pilot of resistance.
Your grandfather said, a great man doesn't seek to lead. He's called to it, and he answers. And if your answer is no, you'll still be the only thing I ever needed you to be. My son.
Boom!
It's so good.
Slam dunk parenting right there.
That's beautiful. He's beautiful.
Find my own way to it.
It's all beautiful.
Maybe you'll find yours.
I found my way to it. Maybe you'll find yours. You know,
give it a try.
My mom was a real believer in. She used to say, "Once you're 18, I did the best I could." And yeah. I loved that. And it's not her saying I'm cutting you loose and I'm not here for you. It's just saying like,
you're your own person.
You're your own person.
Yeah.
There's a tradition I believe is that in a lot of Amish communities, mm-hmm. they're raised with the parents' beliefs, the parents' values, and then at a certain age, they're to go off into the world.
Yeah, Rumspringa.
Okay, so you know better than I do. You even know the name.
Yeah. I don't know. It's like a Dutch word,
uh-huh.
but everything I think is like, it's rum spring. You just go drink a lot of rum. Like, I don't know if that's at all related.
Why is the rum always gone?
But when you go out into the world, and then you decide who you are and who you want to be.
Right, exactly.
And no matter the age, I believe you can tell your child what's going on.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you could do it, like, okay, at their age level or at their understanding level, but you could tell them what's going on instead of stop asking questions. And then the only time I just flat out will refuse to explain is if time is of the essence. Yeah. And at that point, I say, I will explain to you when this is done.
Right.
And then I make sure to do it. So this is fantastic parenting. The inclusion, the I'm treating him like an equal, I'm treating him like a partner. There's a little bit of authoritarian at the beginning because he's drawing it's less of an expectation and more of a hope.
Right.
But then he balances it so nicely with, like, yeah, this is my hope. And yeah. And I love he says, maybe you'll find your way to it.
Yep.
But I don't expect you to.
Mm-hmm.
That's good stuff.
This episode is sponsored by Surfshark.
Surfshark is a VPN, a virtual private network. It'll protect your security online.
Better than any Bene Gesserit witch or even a Sardaukar fighter.
Definitely, and that's great, but we're excited to use it to access different content libraries to watch more of our favorite movies and TV shows.
So if you're traveling, like from Caladan to Arrakis, you can change your virtual location online and still catch up on all your favorite shows and movies and access all your favorite websites.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
Surfshark also helps you to stay safe on public Wi-Fi.
So if you're out and about, like Paul and Jessica wandering in the desert?
You're safe on public networks.
Even from the Baron Harkonnen!
Uh-huh. Surfshark encrypts your data, covering up everything you do online.
Like the Padishah Emperor covering up his real reason for sending Duke Leto to Arrakis!
But then Surfshark isn't evil like he was.
But they could have helped Duke Leto get all the information he needed by getting him past Geoblocks so that he could have seen the betrayal of Dr. Yue coming before it happened.
Wow. And they've got 24/7 support and a cookie pop-up blocker.
Get Surfshark VPN at surfshark.deals/cinematherapy and enter promo code
Cinematherapy
for 83% off and get 3 extra months for free.
Atreides! Atreides!
What's in the box?
What's in the box?
Pain. No need to call the guards.
Just pain. Pain's in the box.
Your mother stands behind that door. No one will get past her.
So this is maybe the one area where I actually
are you doing this?
Preferred the filmmaking
now
in the 80s version.
The scene?
Yeah.
To escape. What will you do?
An animal will gnaw its own arm off to escape. In the 80s version, it's a bit more explicit. You see what he is feeling with his hand, and there's a hand that actually lights on fire and starts melting.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. And it's gnarly. It pushes the limits of what you can do with a PG-13. The performance from Timothy Chalamet is
silence.
Phenomenal.
So his mom has this idea of what she wants him to be, what his purpose is. And while she loves him, it's not about his path like it is with his father. Yeah. And being who he wants to be, he's very much, in her eyes, a child of destiny.
Yeah.
Fear's the mind killer.
And so she's trying to talk herself, fear's the mind killer.
Death that brings obliteration.
Well, and this is also what she's trained him.
Right.
And I'll face my fear, not permit it to pass over me and through me.
And if she's trying to communicate with him across the distance, yeah, there's some of the fire there, then that's one thing. But if she's saying it to herself, it's like, I'm afraid for my son.
Yeah.
I just need to let this happen. This isn't the best parenting, letting your child be tortured. And an actual parallel would be, you know, the type of coaching or training that is...
Yeah, she's like
brutal.
The Ur soccer mom, right? Like, yeah. Pushing her kid to excel.
Or violin, or math, or...
She's like Tiger Mom times a million.
You heard. The Bene Gesserit serve as powerful partners to the great houses. But there's more to it.
You steer the politics of the Imperium from the shadows. I know.
You don't know everything. Thousands of years, we've been carefully crossing bloodlines to bring forth
one.
A mind. Powerful enough to bridge space and time. Past and future. Who can help us into a better future? We think he's very close now. Some believe he's here.
You.
It's all part of a plan.
Paul is seeing his mother for the first time as a Bene Gesserit witch who has created him for a purpose, and it is clouding his views of who and what she is.
Yeah.
Right? Like, for his whole life, she's been his mother, who loves him and is training him in all these Bene Gesserit, you know, like magic, basically, techniques of the voice and these other things. And now he's like, wait a minute. She created me to be the Kwisatz Haderach. I am an object to her.
Yes. And for a lot of parents, they have children to carry on their dreams, carry on.
They're an accessory, right? Yeah. They're like a handbag.
You're here to carry on my legacy and to do the things that I wanted to do that I never did.
Right.
Right. Or to basically to bring me glory.
Sure.
I mean, most parents want what's best for their children, but they fail to see that treating a child like a property,
mm-hmm.
because parenting is a stewardship. You're literally the steward of the child. The proper owner of the child is the child.
Right.
As an adult.
Yep.
And you are a steward guiding them to adulthood and then handing them back to themselves.
That is the weirdest thing you've ever said, but also extremely accurate.
Isn't it?
Die hard! Die hard! Die hard!
Yeah, no, that's a great way to look at parenting. That's really cool.
And so you look at Duke Leto, and he very much is on board with, yeah, I absolutely have dreams and aspirations for my son, but they're not expectations.
Yeah, no, it's up to you. You'll come to it on your own, maybe.
There's something you need to know about Paul.
No. I don't think I want to know. Ever since you brought him before your reverend mother, he hasn't been the same. He's distracted. Jessica, you gave me a son. And from the moment he was born, I never questioned you. I trusted you completely. Even when you walked in shadows. Now I'm asking you this one thing. If anything happens, will you protect our son?
With my life.
I'm not asking his mother, I'm asking the Bene Gesserit. Will you protect Paul?
What do you think is the significance, character-wise, of I'm not asking his mother, I'm asking the Bene Gesserit?
This is what I love about Lady Jessica, because what we saw in the first scene is... You can make a pretty convincing case for this is a simple woman who had one goal, and it was create the Kwisatz Haderach, the chosen one.
Mm-hmm.
And she's not a good mom.
Yeah.
And with this scene and a few other scenes in the film, we see that that is not at all the case. She's an incredibly complex character.
Yeah.
She is his mother. She loves him very much. She also wanted to create the Kwisatz Haderach. And she's trained him to be that. And she is at war with herself about those competing goals because she wants her son to live a, you know, a normal life for the Duke of the second most powerful house in the Empire. But she also wants this thing for the galaxy, and she's constantly at war with herself over that. And she's just a fascinating character.
I see a real life parallel with parents who have split loyalties.
Okay.
So they have their loyalty, I mean, to their child perhaps, but also to their spouse or to their faith. Or to the extended family, or to the expectations of the community, or of the school, or even just their own inner expectations and hopes. And that can get divisive. And so when he says, I'm not asking his mother, I'm asking the Bene Gesserit, I think a modern parallel, for example, could be if I'm raised in a conservative religion, a traditional religion, and I have a child who comes out, right?
Right.
And comes out LGBT, what choice do I make?
Do I love and protect the child, or do I love and protect the tradition?
Yeah, exactly, right?
Yeah.
Or a million other things, or, you know, we talked about in our Turning Red episode, the expectations of previous generations versus honoring the person before me. And since we're on the subject of parenting, all of us have, I don't know if split loyalties is the right term, but all of us wear different hats, and all of us have ties and allegiances to various groups of people and to various causes. Mm-hmm. That's just how we tend to live our lives. When it comes to parenting, in my opinion, the day you become a parent is the day that you sign up to, as far as this person is concerned, I'm going to put them and their needs and their journey first.
Yeah.
Right? And what that looks like in some cases is I've seen parents who say, I'm still going to practice my traditional religion because that's what lands for me and resonates for me.
Sure.
I'm not going to hold my child to that standard. They have the right to choose the path they want to walk. They may leave this.
Yeah.
They may go do something else. And my love for them is, I'm going to honor your journey instead of, no, you must stay. You know, you have to do things my way. You have to see things my way. You have to be what I wanted you to be, what I created you to be. And so I love that question that he asked, because he's saying, okay, as a mother, you would defend him with your life. As the Bene Gesserit, they may say, yeah, he's not the one, so let him die.
Right.
Would you in that role defy them?
Right.
You know?
There may be some context that you're missing too from the books. The Bene Gesserit, in addition to having semi-magical powers, are like super amazing, incredible warriors.
Mm.
So he's actually asking the Bene Gesserit part of her to
be a super
kill people if necessary to protect Paul. So, but it's both, right? He's not just asking her to do that. He's also asking her what you were saying. Are you, the Bene Gesserit, going to destroy this man if he's not the Kwisatz Haderach? Or what, you know, what are you going to do? There's layers, man.
Ogres have layers. Onions have layers. You get it. We both have layers.
Eat popcorn with us. There are 2, 4, or 6 flavors. What's the link?
Lisa'spopcorn.com/cinematherapy. You can have what we're having,
which today is spice flavored popcorn.
Jalapeno cheese. See, it's colored like the sand.
But and it's spicy.
Like spice. And it's hot like the sand.
And it'll make you see things like visions.
Are you seeing things right now?
Yeah.
I think that's something you did before we started shooting. That's not the popcorn. Oh, I love this scene.
So great. She's speaking to him in hand sign.
Remove her gag.
I love the way they did the voice too. Like, the sound design of it is really fun.
Shut up.
Use the force.
Free.
is really Evil Dead sounding.
Yeah,
it's
so great.
It's very scary and creepy.
Stop! Cut the rope! Give me the knife!
I made some more YouTube-friendly cuts here. This very, very, very much, aside from the murder, feels like my relationship with my mom.
Mm-hmm.
I know she loves me.
Yeah.
And the way she shows that she loves me is by telling me my pitch is too forced.
Not quite my tempo.
Even after I did something right, she's like, and it could have been better. Here's how.
What are you, in a fucking a cappella group? Play the goddamn kit!
And that, for a long time, really, really bothered me. And caused me daily pain. And I've mostly, at this point, accepted, like, oh, that's how she shows love.
Start practicing harder, Neiman.
And, you know.
People like that, people who parent like that, in my experience, internally, they're as hard on themselves as they are on anybody else.
Oh, very much so, yeah.
Right? It's always the standard of perfection that cannot be attained. It's always, things can be better. This details off, that details off. And sure, there's a component of genuine love there. Like, the better you are at this, the better your life will go.
Yeah.
And I want that for you.
Mm-hmm.
But at what point does it become a complex?
Right.
You know, and at what point are you not able to just enjoy your life or enjoy your relationship with your child because you're so honed in on, this could be better, that could be better, this could be... And in her case, of course, she's put all this pressure on herself because she's created him to be Sand Messiah. And I know you've talked about your mom doing this, like, she wanted to prepare you for life and prepare you for the real world and all that stuff.
Yeah, she did a great job.
Yeah, she did. She did. But at a certain point, you lose whatever influence you could have had because you lose the respect of your child.
Right.
At a certain point, they stop trying to win your approval.
And they just start rebelling.
Yeah, because they get the idea, I'm never going to win your approval. I've been trying to do it for years. And now at this point, I'm just pissed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I hoped for a long time that you would finally be loving and tender and affectionate with me, and it never happened. And at this point, I don't give a damn what you have to say.
Right.
Oh, you're scared. I can see it. Tell me, please, what do you fear?
So he's been, they're on Arrakis now, out in the desert, and he's been breathing in spice, which extends life, makes your eyes blue, and lets you see visions.
Please. It's coming. I see unholy war spreading across the universe like unquenchable fire. A warrior religion that waves the Atreides banner in my father's name. Fanatical legions worshiping at the shrine of my father's skull. A war in my name! Everyone shouting my name! You are your father's son. You are my son. You are the Duke. Paul Atreides. You know who you are. You know who you are.
Get off me! You did this to me! You Bene Gesserit made me a freak!
There's real remorse there at the cost that it's taken.
Yeah.
But I don't know that she would have chosen any different. Like, I don't know that she's looking at the situation saying, I wish I'd done different. I think she's looking at it saying, this is what it took, and that's really hard, and it makes me sad.
Yeah. Again, she's such a complex, interesting character.
Mm-hmm. This was written in the 70s, wasn't it?
Late 50s, early 60s, I think.
In the 60s. You breathe in spice and you see things.
You breathe in spice and you see things, and it was the 60s.
Hey, Meg, I'm a hippie now, and I'm feeling the burn.
Bernie Sanders?
No, none of my hippie girlfriends shower and my crotch itches.
His dad wanted him to find his own way.
Yeah. And his mom had a way for him to go.
And now it's the way he's going. He's seeing visions of the future, and it feels like he's locked into this, and this is what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And he's furious at her.
Mm-hmm.
Because she took away his free will. She took away what his father was trying to give him, which was, all I ever needed was for you to be my son. And she needs him to be so much more.
Yeah.
So outside of Disney films, usually the mother is fantastic and the father sucks. Mm-hmm. So we've got an interesting reversal here. And I'm not saying she sucks. I'm saying
she's complex.
She's complex.
And Duke Leto is a lot less complex.
She's
trying to do the right thing.
She's a good person. And I think she could be a great hero's journey mentor. Is she a good mom? No, she's not. Okay. I can go ahead and categorically say that. Because good intentions don't translate into good actions. You have to honor the journey. You have to honor the free will. I'm curious, having not read the books or seen the other versions, in the second half, if these visions that he's seeing are going to be, what is that coy, knowing smile?
The second film's going to be really fun.
Well, that's good. I think it's interesting that he uses the voice on her for the first time, just for a second, like when he shouts at her and she gets back. This is akin as a parent to when your child says something to you and you don't like it, but you know they're basically quoting you.
Yeah.
You know?
When they quote you back at you to prove you wrong.
Yeah.
It's like, oh no, I've made a Jedi.
One thing I do like about her parenting here, because I don't want to throw her completely under the bus, is that when he lashes out, instead of, you will not speak to me this way, I am your mother, I am a member of the Bene Gesserit, she just lets him rage.
And then comforts him.
And then comforts him.
Yeah.
That she actually puts him before her in this scene, and that's beautiful.
You know, going into the second half of the story, she does a lot more of that. She kind of takes a back seat. It gets to...
And you start to see it more towards the end of the film, where she's letting him stand on his own feet and find his own way.
Well, and letting him do that, she's also questioning her own, you know, value and worth, kind of. Like, there's some more complexity. And he's just taking charge and not letting her do things anymore, too.
Yeah.
There's a lot of layers of stuff going on. It's fascinating.
Well, and that's part of stepping into adulthood as well. I know a lot of people that I've seen in therapy who their parents continue to meddle in their adult lives. Mm-hmm. And I say to the person, yes, but you're the adult who needs to draw the boundary at this point.
Yep.
You know, that you can't expect your parent to back away. They've already shown that they won't. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to be the one to say, I love you, I will always love you, and I will always hear your counsel and consider it, but I'm now an adult, and I'm going to make my own decisions, and some of those will be decisions that you wouldn't make, you know, but this is my life.
Yeah.
And some parents do not like that,
mm-hmm.
and some people don't want to do that because they don't want to burn the bridge with their parents, but it is an essential part of having a healthy relationship with your parents as an adult. And if they can't honor that, then maybe you can't have a healthy relationship. And you have to decide between being controlled or having a life.
You have to decide between being a human and being an animal.
Yes.
That's what the Reverend Mother.
Oh, yes. Or a manimal.
Or a manimal.
Manimal.
Man, I'm really looking forward to part two.
Are you as well?
Let's go opening day. That'll be a fun one.
Okay, bring it on.
And then...
In IMAX if they have it.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I am enjoying the story, but the artistry is where it's really hooked.
These are definitely films to see on the big screen.
Like, yeah.
If you have the opportunity, any Denis Villeneuve film. And this, man, I have such a weird relationship with him because I don't like... arty farty movies.
No, you do not.
Yeah, this is not me. I like Marvel movies, I like Spielberg movies, I like action and comedy and enough drama to make me cry, but not enough to make me think.
Yeah.
You know? Like, that's what I like. And Denis Villeneuve makes art films.
Yeah.
They are. Have you seen Arrival?
Arrival is fantastic.
Beautiful, amazing movie. Not at all what I would normally, like, gravitate to, and it's one of my favorite films of the last 10 years.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's doing, but it's keep doing it.
And they're slow and ponderously paced, and I still find them so engrossing.
Engrossing, exciting at times.
Yeah.
Just, man, this, yeah. Thank you, Denis Villeneuve. Thank you, Denis Villeneuve.
Denis Villeneuve.
What?
There can be miracles when you are me.
So until next time.
Cut the rope!
Your pitch was off.
And
watch movies!
Bless the Maker and his water. Bless the coming and going of him. May his passage cleanse the world and keep the world for his people.